Sit the mouse trip.
Okay, let's do it one more
time.
Come on, we'll
take
this
from here.
Oh, you already have a marble.
That's the.
Never got myself.
Right?
Today.
That was the most.
That was our most.
They get very attached to what they design. But usually at the end, they end up with another really cool design that some other group came up with, and so they eventually get over it. But that's one way to really push for the importance of being able to communicate ideas in a written form then. Other thoughts?
Well, I like the focus on the use of vocabulary.
it can be another mechanism through which that literacy part comes through. And again, if you, for instance, there is a story component that could be added to something like this, and that could also further push for that literacy in the way that you can add, you can use the machine almost as an analogy, a metaphor for something else. And so sometimes having sort of smaller groups that then have to interface with other groups could be one way to help those students so that they don't have to take on the big group all at once. Maybe you have them work in a smaller group so they feel a little more comfortable, and then you sort of have that group interface with others. So that could be one way to make an active learning group environment less intimidating for students who just have problems in engaging in that. But or don't like, that's not their strong point, let me put it that way. Nothing was wrong with that. Yes?
We were talking a little bit, Dr. Shapiro, about the thoughts that she had about working with non-community college kids, and that when you're working with others, maybe that handful of kids are not comfortable with that because they're autistic and they don't maybe have that social ability to say, this is where I want to come in and do this. And we were kind of brainstorming and saying, you know, what are some things we could do to make them feel a little bit more comfortable? And one thing we were thinking of that might work for all of our kids is making it a little less open-ended, in that we might have jobs. Like, okay, while you're doing this, one person needs to be a trainer, one person needs to do this. And so maybe you've got a kid who really enjoys doing repetitive things. You build the tracks. You blow up the balloons. You know, you give them some sort of a job that is an entry point for them that makes them feel more comfortable. Or perhaps having a buddy system where you know there's a kid that might have a tough time with it, and you take a kid to go buddy up to him, they can maybe verbalize what you want and kind of keep that kid in check. Just trying to come up with some ideas about how to do it.
And so even for us, and we have Susan speak a little more to this, when we do teamwork at the college level, sometimes we do sometimes spend some time just talking about some team dynamics, but assigning roles within the teams could be useful in making everybody have a very specific focus that they are responsible for in that particular team. So Susan,
Engineering might attract more than its share of folks who may have struggles with interacting with folks. Often the students think that it's just being a team member, and that's either you're born a good team member or you're not. So we do try to spend time talking about what does it mean to be a good team member. And there are, you know, there's lots of stuff out there, but one of the things that does help them is to have roles. So for example, I have my students do their homework in teams, because a lot of them are going to work in teams anyway, but I don't want anybody left out in my room, whether you're a transfer student or you're the only whatever, veteran or black student or woman or whatever. I want to make sure everyone has a team, but I want to make sure that they rotate the roles in those teams. So I assign the teams and I assign the roles and how they're going to rotate them. So one person writes up the homework each week and they have to rotate that around. And I'm sorry if somebody's handwriting's nicer than the other ones, they still have to take turns. I have somebody who's in charge of making sure everybody knows when they're meeting, and I have somebody who's in charge of checking it at the end, make sure you did all the problems and you did all the units and everything for me, etc. And I think that structure helps to take it from sort of vague or whatever to something that they're learning multiple skills as they're going on in there. And there's some stuff also, if you're interested, there's other stuff that helps to be able to analyze how good you're being as a teammate, evaluating each other in teams, that breaks it down into different dimensions of being a team instead of just saying generically what does it mean to be a good team member. And some of this has website support for it so that students go in and they rate and then you get feedback that you can give directly to them.
My team decided to do next year is, instead of just in our rubrics for projects or engineering activities or whatever, instead of just grading, you know, the content, we're also grading those soft skills like collaboration, cooperation, creativity, and actively teaching that instead of passively teaching it. So every time there's an activity, the kids will get their feedback on how well they cooperated, how well they collaborated, and really maybe teaching those 21st century skills and active part of the curriculum.
Yeah, that's great. Just, you don't want students to think that you have to be born either being a good team member or a good communicator, just like all the other growth mindset things, that these are things that they can work on developing. Are there other things people want to share as far as how you could take this to your classroom? I do think another piece that I think may be useful is that idea that we let you set some of the criteria. We didn't. We debated about this actually the first time we did it. Said, is it going to take too long? Because once we let you open those kits, it's going to get really loud in this room. It's going to be really hard for us to. We're not as good as you are about teacher voice and getting everybody back. So is it worth it? And then we decide, yeah, I think it's worth it because, like, there were certain folks who really owned their thing that they had come up with. Right, so they're then the police of the other ones or whatever. But so that could be used in any sort of environment where you have something where you might have some criteria. You could come up with some if they're really critical, but then having the students come up with some gives them some more kind of ownership and a more student-centered experience.
One of the questions I think was posed that biology teachers might have a hard time with this because, you know, it's like how do you attach something, but maybe you can have the students, like you did with us, have a story, like maybe some illustration. Cycle, and label each piece of their reaction to how they would consider the reactions, and label their pieces of their machine
right.
Like that machine.
So that becomes a model of that other kind of. I'm going to give Sharon the microphone for a minute to, as we were trying to say, so what can we do for these biology? Because that's the question we get a lot, right? And so part of it is the pedagogical pieces, right? That the we're not saying you have to go do Rube Goldberg machines, you know, but you might have students come up with some criteria. You might have small teams that work with larger teams. You might have the open-ended contest where everyone can win, right? But actually, Sharon had some good ideas about how it could even apply more content-wise that I think dovetail with some of what you just said.
Kind of similar to the same thing. I was thinking the first thing when they started explaining the Rube Goldberg, I immediately thought of my struggles with explaining concepts of chain reactions, whether it's a homeostatic mechanism, or like you're saying, the Krebs cycle, where one thing has a knock-on effect on the other, and they have a hard time sort of conceptualizing that, and that you could use the Rube Goldberg concept of a knock-on effect that would be helpful in a lot of those mechanistic kind of things that we see in biology, and also in chemical reactions, like the idea of a chain reaction, cascading events, like with something, one thing falling and then creating a whole bunch of dominoes, and now you have 10 dominoes falling and it's increasing like a cascade event, and those sort of things that are conceptually hard to do, and maybe that's true for chemistry too, I don't know. But that's what some of the things I came up with.
I kind of know that. I was thinking with chemistry, the reliability is the chain of events that happen when you're doing analysis like a titration. The weighing, how reliable is the weighing? Your standardization, how reliable is that? And then that all cascades into your final result.
I was also just thinking in terms of biology, some of like the biochem stuff that you're saying, but like a catalyst. Kids have a hard time understanding what a catalyst is. So if you talk about how a pulley reduces the amount of energy needed to move something, you can tie physics, chemistry, into biology. You can tie all those together, and they have a more better framework, I guess you'd say, of vocabulary. But then also, I was thinking of other things. I mean, everything from like the water cycle or like a food chain, you know, that if you put a little coyote inside of a car, it chases a rabbit, and this triggers this. And I mean, there's things you could do. The problem I would see is in 52 minutes with 35 kids, and I can't leave it set up because I have another class coming in. You know, the timing, that would be the difficult thing. But something like after school or as a club or a contest or something, I think.
With six steps.
Yeah.
And you could remember, Odessa said she has them do her the plan ahead of time. So maybe one right. class period they plan, and the next class period they walk in and they start to build. And then
right.
that would change some of the dynamics, how much time you would need.
One of the ideas that was kicked around here is first period starts, second period picks up.
Period. That's good, right? Then your documentation has to be good enough that someone can figure out what on earth it was you said you were doing.
Right,
and that's good for the whole collaboration system within a system, all that stuff.
I was thinking about this in terms of reaction mechanisms and reaction dynamics, where you have a whole bunch of potential reactions. And all it takes is one thing to activate each one.
Right, and so then you might not need, you might be able to structure that so it didn't take as much time or whatever.
You actually use the chemistry in the reactor.
Cool, good. So lots of good ideas. So again, we're not saying everyone has to go do a Rube Goldberg machine. But if you want to, there are these kits will be available for Melanie, and you could do it again. And, yeah, you could have kids bring in materials if you wanted or whatever, but we're hoping that the kind of the approach of it gives you some ideas into the kinds of questions that engineers ask and the ways that we might approach our problem solving.
Yeah,
and then And it just may mean too that with some of the biological sciences, maybe more of the emphasis is really spent on the upfront side where you're just really trying to define that problem through identifying what the requirements are or the criteria is or what the constraints are. And that may be where you bring in some of that understanding about your environment and what's the different food chains aspects, you know, what is necessary for this particular organism to survive, etc. And using that knowledge to really begin to define and what must be necessary in order for a successful system to exist. And just that part, I mean, sometimes, you know, when you think of engineering, people think, well, it has to be this hands-on thing. It has to be this really actively engaged. But there has to be that thought that has to come before that in order for it to be done well. And you know, if we can show our students how that part is really sometimes the real challenging part, and that, I think, is really easily applicable in the biological sciences, for sure. So one hand, yes.
I have an idea for how you could use this for biology. I was thinking that you could sort of do it, but have them say that their theme is they need to model the circulatory system. And so they need to come up with different ways that the blood goes from one organ to the next, and you have some sort of a catheter and it works them out with actually like marbles coming down and gathering back together, going out, and sort of thinking about how you start off with your big push, which is the heart, and how arteries have pushes along the way, where these veins allow it to drain back, something like that.
And you could even start off, I mean, this shows my lack, but if there was a problem, I mean, let's say suppose person A had a clot or something, how would you address that problem? And they model sort of the approach to solve it, because we want to really emphasize that the engineering is really about trying to address a particular challenge. So it could just be about modeling it, but it could be, let's say there is a problem in the system, how do you now apply your understanding of that system to address it? And they could, as you said, do that in a more physical sense, since you know, they couldn't do it in the real body sense, but they can use more visuals to help explain their particular solution. That's an excellent idea. Any last comments before I turn it over to Cynthia?
So let's thank the engineers for getting our engineering juices flowing and growing and excited and everything else. So thanks everyone for all of your hard work today. We do have quite a few videos that are going to be blowing up Melanie's email box, I think. Or perhaps our videographer will be able to take care of things. I wanted to remind everyone that the Bitly is our interactive agenda, and all of the handouts will be online. We're in the process of putting them all there, and then in addition to that, there will also be materials in Canvas. And this agenda goes day by day. So if you want to recall what happened in one particular day and you wanted to look for a resource, this will be our interactive resource. So make sure you write down that Bitly address. Okay, so one of the things that we wanted to share with you is that there are many Rube Goldberg examples. You saw that there were cartoons. You saw that there were additional videos. There's one video in particular that is Audrey. And Audrey is a male name. It's a young man. And he really talks about, or I would say exemplifies, trial and error. And with all of us, we know that if at first you don't succeed, try and try again. What's the next part of that?
Keep on sucking
to you succeed.
Okay. Try again.
I'm Audrey Clement, and machine.
How many of you have seen this before?
The machine that creates a chain reaction.
Sorry about the Honda commercial.
A complicated one to make it a simple task. And both of yourself. Myra Goldberg is going to start with this domino being knocked down. They're going to fall all the way up here, knocking down this bowling pin, creating a shockwave, spinning this gyroscope, pushing the marker top, laying down here, around the spiral, down this ramp, hitting this switch control power socket. Turning on this toaster. When the toaster's done, this lever will pop up, letting a ball fall out. Knocking all the balls off. Hitting this paper roll. Running down here. Hitting this big towel tube. Knocking down this wine glass with a fishy ball on top. Fishy ball will fall off. And letting this thing fall on the toaster. And we're going to don't always work on the first try. So this is much successes and how much failures. I think we'll have. This is my hypothesis, this is the actual. My hypothesis on successes is 2. I think we'll have 10 to 20 failures and 2 successes. But that's my hypothesis.
That one you'll be able to take back with you because it's certainly online. It's my absolute favorite one for Ruth Goldberg, but there is one more because I know that many of you are high school teachers, and I think you'll appreciate this one as well.
This is our Rube Goldberg machine. There's a bunch of
goes all
stuff
the way
in it. It goes across the room and outside. Not that far outside. Okay, it all starts.
Not exactly the best videography,
right here.
But.
You're going to flip that switch. When that happens, over here, this fan will turn on. Now, if you look closely, there is a string right here. See that? Kind of hard to see. String attached from the fan blade over here, goes through this pocket, comes down here, and is attached to this area.
Holy sock.
Notice the holy sock.
This bike tire. When the fan turns on, it'll pull this string, yanking out this arrow, and then the tire will release because of stress from the ab lounge, and the ab lounge will move that bar forward, knocking down those boxes, which will hit that triangle, pulling that string, and releasing the ball perched right there, which will then flow down the sticks and into that pocket over there.
This ball will then fall onto this track we made. Show it over here. Go around this turn, hit this little thing we made, which will knock down this 5-pound dumbbell. Then it'll pull these popsicle sticks out of this ping pong net. This ball will roll down the net, hit this soccer ball. This soccer ball has a fish line attached to it, which the camera can't pick up, but it's gonna go down the stairs, pull the fish line. It's gonna pull this hammer, which is attached to the TV button, turn the TV on, at the same time lift our life-size Obama. As you can see, Mari's about to show it to you. It's gonna lift Obama forward. Obama's gonna hit this basketball, which is gonna hit these dominoes. This golf ball is gonna go in here, and it's gonna shoot out like that, which will then hit that dumbbell. Then this dumbbell will pull this big bucket of popsicle sticks, and all these popsicle sticks will hit the chair, hitting this bouncy ball. It'll go down the tape slide thing, hit the button will fly to the tail again.
You notice the vocabulary.
The plate over there.
It's not there.
Oh, smash. It's gonna make some gorgeous mashed potatoes so we can have dinner and a movie.
That's right.
All right, number 7.
It's so important for the students to go ahead and do predictive analysis. Some of the tools that are out there, this particular one, interactive physics was one of the first interactive products that was created in the from the software world. And it was originated on the Mac, but now it is also online. And if you are teaching physics or have a physics component that you want to use as a cross-cutting concept, and bringing in some of the things like scale and value and things that can go across the board. I wanted to show you another, this particular, it is a .com, but it does have a lot of really great simulations as well. And the one that I downloaded that I think really demonstrates a lot of concepts is one that simulates a drum pedal. Now, this is a, who doesn't like to play drums? No. So there's just a variety of here of there's a subway door arm. There's a simulation of the drum pedal, and they also, it's not just streaming on the internet. You can also download it as an MP4 file, so that way you can transfer it. And then there's all kinds of other simulations that have been. Here's your Simscape multi-body. And just I just wanted to make sure that you knew about this particular resource as well. So not only does it have the software that you can do simulation and create simulations with, but it also has products. These are the particular products, and you can see students. Have you ever heard everybody itch your scratch? You know about Scratch? Scratch, who uses Scratch here? Scratch here is a way to, and I know Shannon, you scratch with your students, or you don't just scratch, but you use Scratch. Okay, so Shannon knows, do you tickle? That's right, do you scratch, do you tickle? A lot of these devices that are you're creating a simulated environment, and you're also doing trial and error, cause and effect, et cetera, et cetera. And Scratch really is, as many other programming languages, it's coming in vogue again. So you want to make sure that students, even I'm seeing kids as young as kindergarten who are using their iPads and using in learning how to program. And that also is a way to create a simulation. So that concludes some of the resources that I've culled for you, that I've curated for you. And as we continue to develop our learning communities, if you find a great resource, either put it on your playlist if you have a YouTube channel, and we can start to share some of these wonderful resources and start to categorize them and start to assign them to the place in the NGSS standards that we can link to, and then we'll be able to collaboratively build our lessons together. So, hope you like that, and we're at 2:45, exactly. And the sound worked!
Real quickly, guys, tomorrow we're going to be environmental engineers. So if you have any recyclable items, I just brought a box in of just stuff like egg cartons, Q-tips, toilet paper rolls, like yarn, just a small amount. You know, we don't need a lot. But if you have like a handful of just recyclable items at home, if you could bring some different things in so we have some different items from which to choose for tomorrow.
Okay, besides the custodian and the principal secretary, who should you be like best friends with at your school site? The tech person now. The person in the school who has the most people, family members. Because if you need stuff, you can always ask them. Somebody's got 8 kids. Hey, I need some toilet paper rolls for this roller coaster. You'll get those toilet paper rolls and you'll be able to make your roller coasters in no time. Yep. Yeah, exactly. There was this guy that I worked with that I don't know how many kids he had. But I'm like, oh, you know what? Hey, Steve, I'm doing my roller coaster physics project. He goes, oh, you need some toilet paper rolls? I said, sure. And I mean, I swear I got like a bag of them like in 2 days. So, yeah. So it does help pay to be, yeah. Okay, so very quickly, this was developed by a teacher at Olympian High School. And this is a science and engineering. It's also in the Canvas. And, you know, I told you I'm still a snail in Canvas. Stuff will get put in there slowly but surely. We'll get it all populated. This is a really kind of thinking metacognition for your students, and today it can be for you because you were students and creators today, talking about what you've learned, how you learned it, and just giving you some information about the science practices that we've used, like Odesma and Cynthia were just mentioning. So did everybody get one of these? There's also one in your binder. So did everybody get a binder? Here with your subject area, a folder, binder, folder. Sorry, we're low budget, folder. But I'm not saying low budget. I'm saying the folder is more earth friendly than the plastic binder. Okay, so make sure you guys get one of these folders with your subject area on it. And now you will take it with you because we are not coming back to the fleet. So you will take it with you to East Lake High tomorrow. So again, take a look at this. you know, for a couple minutes here. And this is something very helpful. When you have your students do a project, an engineering project or a lab, you can have them take a look. You know what I did? I asked questions and defined problems, analyzed and interpreting data. I obtained, evaluated, and communicating information. So you guys did that today with your machines. And like sentence starters, in this lesson, I used the practice of, by, how did I use asking questions and defining problems. So I think this is great. And then you can have them, I found it difficult to, I've never done. So I think this is a great example for things that you could use with your students. So just take a look at this, and just as we find things that are helpful, we'll share them. And if you have anything to share, you know, please do so, because more heads are better than one. Okay. Now, the last thing is, I had to give out one of these awards earlier, but this person did not want any recognition. His name rhymes with Homan Hel Ho Hario. And I gave him his award because of all the support he's given, but he didn't want me to recognize him. So we do want to thank our boss for giving us food and the extra people that are able to attend today, and for signing all the crazy documents, me running around trying to get them signed, and chasing down Dr. Janney as well to get things signed for this grant. But we decided to have one of our, when I think of a light bulb, I think of light, I can see, but I also think of an invention. I think of the engineering and how many times that someone went through to make us the light bulb, to create Thomas Edison and some of his predecessors. So this was one of the greatest feats of engineering, is right here, is in the shape of this light bulb. Of course, I think they were different shape back then, but and now, of course, the compact fluorescent, we're still changing. You know, this is iterations of a light bulb. So every day, we're the engineers and myself, the professors, are kind of looking at people who've maybe they've triumphed in one of their activities, or they've done something pretty awesome. And we already have our people picked out for tomorrow, but we're a day behind. So yesterday there were two people who really did a great job. They did the trial and error. They were following procedures when they did their tower, and they built it and they won, and they've had awesome attitudes. And Rachel Stein came up with one of the best, you're gonna see it tomorrow, chemistry teachers, and versions of it. She came up with such a great outline for us to use for our planning for, because tomorrow you're gonna be with your people. You're gonna be with your peeps. Patrick, you're gonna be with your physics peeps. Yeah. You're gonna be with them. You're gonna be there. Okay. So now, but you've made some great friends today. Awesome, new friends, middle school teachers, high school teachers playing together. Wow, who thought that could happen? Cats and dogs, yeah. All right, so Rachel Meisner is the recipient of the award for everything she's done, and for the tallest, best tower for yesterday.
Awesome.
Okay, and she couldn't have done this alone. Bobby Collins was her partner. And Bobby's always someone I can go to and go, hey, Bobby, was this okay? And she'll tell me straight up, no, it wasn't. Or, I really like this, and you could add to this. And 99.9% of the time, I'll do what she tells me to do. So thank you guys for being great and getting the first, well, second and third ESP awards, not ESPN or ESPY, ESP, yeah, it comes out of your head, ESP awards. So share it proudly somewhere like on your shelf. Okay, and then two more folks will get one tomorrow, but you don't know who you are yet. I do, but you don't. All right. Okay.